Definitely first port of call for looking up on any culture is the website, and when you go to peloton.com, or rather onepeloton.com, you can see straight away that it's some kind of exercise equipment business. They've got bicycles, they've got treadmills, they've got accessories, they've got apparel, and so it immediately strikes you that they're a little bit like Apple. They sell you hardware, right? But then there's also classes free on this app, so presumably there is some kind of a content streaming model. They offer you workouts like cycling, running, strength, yoga, boot camp, cardio, meditation, outdoor stuff. Let's see what else. Stretching, walking, cycling, running. So basically all the cool kind of like sports where you can get involved and get some cardio and get some exercise in. Okay, there you go. So you can, the bike start at nearly 2,000 bucks per bike. That's not cheap, but that also means that the higher the price, maybe the fatter the margin. It's also in some installment basis. You can pay 50 bucks a month, give or take. That maybe equates to a 3-year plan. So obviously that's interesting. That could be the entry level bike. Mashable says it's worth every penny. Forbes says you can get a really better than the gym workout at home. It's called Peloton. USA Today says it's attractive, addictive, and seriously whips you into shape. Right, so what I also like to do is check out the investor page where you can get a bit more information. And on the investor page, you can see that what they tell you is that they are an interactive fitness platform. About 5.5 million members. They've got technology-enabled fitness, immersive instructor-led boutique classes. They make entertainment, fitness entertaining, approachable, effective, social connections, world-class instructors. So basically what they've got is, yeah, this many members, this many workouts, about 150 million workouts in the third quarter. 92% 12-month retention rate. That means, I guess, more than 9 out of every 10 people who sign up to Peloton stick around after that. And they've got quarterly revenue of $1.3 billion. That's pretty good. If you also want to check out more on the company, you can also look at the S1. The S1 filing is what they must, the company, tell the SEC before they go for listing. And presumably, Peloton listed in August, or rather after August 2019. So Peloton Interactive, let's see, look through the S1. Goldman's advised on the listing, JP Morgan as well, and all these other big banks like Merrill Lynch and Barclays and UBS and Cowen. So obviously the bigger the bank, the bigger the, I guess, the potential that they see in the business. They say they are a technology, media, software, product experience that is involved in fitness, design, retail, apparel, logistics. So it's a little bit like Apple meets Netflix meets Lululemon, because obviously they also have a content streaming business. This is what they reported at the time. Obviously the revenues are a lot higher. And here you can see the table of contents. Let's look at dividend policy for a little bit. They say they have never declared or paid cash dividends. They currently intend to retain all available funds and any future earnings for use in the operation of the business. Do not anticipate paying any dividends on the stock in the foreseeable future. Okay, so that means every single cent that they make from here on in until sometime in the future, they will put towards growing the business in America, I presume, in Europe and the rest of the world. And I think they're also trying to get into Australia. Second key question to ask when assessing a company is the people, because the people and their strategy and their drive and their ambition and their energy really drive the business. And without a good team, you cannot get a high potential, high quality business. So onto the leadership team of Peloton, and you can see that John Foley is the man with a master plan. He's the co-founder and CEO. Then look through the key people. This guy, William Lynch, is the president. Jill Woodworth is the CFO. Interesting. This guy, Tom Cortese, is another co-founder. Hisao Kushi is another co-founder. and this guy Yoni Feng is another co-founder. So presumably four co-founders, all in charge of key roles within the business. John Foley is the man in charge overall. Cortese is the guy in charge of product development and operations. Hisao Kushi is the legal guy. Yoni Feng is the technology guy. But operationally, from a day-to-day, on a day-to-day basis, William Lynch, the president, and Jill Woodworth are the key people. So click through the John Foley's LinkedIn and you can see that this is a man with a lot of experience. He started way back in 1990 with Mars, the British confectioner. Production shift. Then he went on to City Search and operations. He went on to Ticketmaster and as a general manager. Then leadership with Evite, which I think is an invitation or electronic invitation business. Then Pronto.com and then Prowse.com as a founder and chief executive. Founded these two businesses, Pronto and founder. Then the big one here, Barnes & Noble, president of e-commerce. Of course, Barnes & Noble is the brick and mortar library book store business that went online. And then, of course, 9 years ago, he started Peloton with the other guys. Now click through to William Lynch. William Lynch is a guy who was also in charge of, I guess, day-to-day operations, one of the top people in the business. He started off also around the same time, 2000, in charge of digital marketing and e-commerce with Palm, the handheld business, which I think might be extinct today. He was also in charge of Gifts.com, then HSN, I think his home shopping network, marketing head, and then of course the two big roles that he's had, Barnes & Noble Digital and Barnes & Noble Chief Executive. Spent 4.5 years there, and of course from there on he joined Peloton 4.5 years ago as president. Now Jill Woodworth, of course, is also instrumental. She's the Chief Financial Officer. Now it looks like she's a career investment banker. nearly 12 years at Morgan Stanley and 12 years and a bit at JP Morgan. JP Morgan, of course, we know from the S1 filing that they're the ones, one of the ones who took Peloton public. Then, of course, 3 years ago, she joined Peloton as Chief Financial Officer. So, okay, so based on the top three managers, they seem to be in quite good hands. One thing I also like to look at is the overall team within Peloton and see how diverse they are, how energetic they seem to be. And on the face of it, they're quite well spread in terms of gender, in terms of racial makeup, also in terms of age. So Karina Kogan in charge of marketing, Dara Treseder, comms, Dion Sanders, strategy, Shubs Aluwalia, information, Brad Olson, memberships, John Eddy, supply chain, Jennifer Cotter, content, Shanahan, Tim, revenue officer, Mariana Garavaglia, chief business operations, Yoni Feng, aforementioned, technology, Kevin Cornells, international business, Hisao Kushi, one of the co-founders, legal guy, Tom Cortese, operations of product development, and of course, Jill Woodworth, William Lynch, and John Foley. So I guess on the back of that, interesting team, and they seem to have the chops. So one thing I'd like to try and do is I want to look at how John Foley or the chief executive of any company that I'm looking at performs under intense questioning or being interviewed by one of the big few media companies. Bloomberg is one of them, the Financial Times, of course, CNBC. And I found this from Bloomberg Technology about 2 months ago, 2 months and a bit ago, quite recent. And the headline is interesting. It's about how Peloton can still grow 100 times more. So let's see how he does.
Obviously, it has been an unprecedented year for you. The surge in demand, the unprecedented challenges to meet that demand, you leading the company through it while dominating the Peloton leaderboards, by the way. Talk to us about how well you think, looking back on the last year, how well do you think Peloton met the moment?
I think we did really well. I was super proud of our team. I mean, it was unprecedented and unanticipated. Of course, we've grown 100% year on year since we launched the company, so we were planning to have a great growth year. But we just had a team meeting this morning, and our manufacturing team told us that over the last 12 months, they've grown supply 700% since this time, or the capacity of supply 700%, which is just crazy Herculean to try and keep up with the growth. So. Emily, I think you probably saw that we, our instructors were innovative and our content team were, once our studios closed, we moved the instructors to their homes, to their living rooms, to their bedrooms to be able to stream fresh content to our members. Our stores closed, and those retail folks.
I just want to pipe in and say that basically a minute into the interview, he talks about how supply has increased by a few hundred percent. That's quite instrumental because, as I know, the pandemic disrupted their supply production line and they were not able to meet demands. He also talked about how instructors are a key thing for them because without instructors, there are no exercises to guide clients who then, you know, obviously may not be as incentivized to exercise if they didn't have those instructors to egg them on. And then, of course, I just want to point out the fact that Peloton listed their shares May 2020, increased by nearly sixfold to nearly 180 bucks in January last, in fact, January this year. But then they've come off. And of course, this is reflective of the fact that with the US economy back on track-ish and the vaccination rollout program on track-ish, more Americans have left the home and presumably less demand for their workout equipment because more Americans are you know, out and about rather than spending time in their, you know, in their homes exercising.
Jumped on the phones to help people get on board with Peloton treads and bikes, and on and on. I feel like we've been there for our members. We've welcomed you know, hundreds of thousands of new members, and I've been really pleased. I've been incredibly proud of the team.
John, you're absolutely right. I spent a lot of time with Bex Gentry. She is my favorite. But look, the big question is, how does the growth evolve post-pandemic?
Yeah, so we know that Peloton makes a big deal out of their instructors. They say that they are world-class. And according to the profile of Bex Gentry, she is a Londoner, I think. She does trail running, tropical beaches, exotic volcanoes, sub-3-hour marathons, demanding ultra-marathons. So obviously she is de rigueur among runners.
Gyms reopening, life settling into a new normal. What does the demand picture look like to you as vaccines roll out?
And of course, not being unattractive, this is important for Peloton because, you know, you want to have that eye candy. Like it or not, we are superficial people. To have an attractive instructor is obviously very important.
As vaccines roll out and after vaccines, are done?
Yeah, so about 6 months ago, there was a survey done by a national company that said that they found that 59% of Americans are not going to go back to the gym after COVID's done. So this whole idea that you can now get better workouts at home without traveling at a better value, because on average, a Peloton workout costs around $2 per workout when you think about how much members and their families are using, you know, their spouse are also riding or running on the Peloton treads or bikes. And so it's a better value, it's a better location, better instructors. To your point, we believe we've got the best instructors in the world. So with the better experiences, a better value, a better location, that's undefeated. And so I think the word is out that Peloton has these experiences. Like you just heard, the word of mouth is really helping us because people get addicted to them. They say, why would I go back to the gym? Why would I travel for an inferior experience? And that, you know, COVID or no COVID, that's a universal. So we believe that the growth we've seen is going to continue for years and years to come. You know, I will tell you of interest, Emily, the total addressable market as we see it is close to 200 million gym goers around the world. We have just under 2 million subscribers. So we could grow, we believe, 100x before we're starting to really feel like the, you know, the growth may slow.
So that's your corporate message. Within the first 3 and a bit minutes, he points out that nearly 60% of Americans, according to a study, will not go back to gyms post-pandemic, and obviously preferring to work from home. And according to Peloton's numbers, just $2 per workout, which is obviously much cheaper than going to the gym. He also points out that the total addressable market is 200 million users around the world. I guess that's according to some surveys as well. And with only 2 million subscribers, that means they've only hit 1% of the addressable market. So this is important because with any listed company, it's all about the future. And if they got 99% of the total addressable market to get to, then even if they hit 30% of that, there's another 30 times worth of growth, or another 30x worth of growth to go. I think overall, John Foley has acquitted himself quite well. Does he have the energy and the vigor and the strategy and the experience? It would appear so. Just nitpicking, of course, I'm not too sure about his background. That painting doesn't quite acquit itself in terms of Peloton's brand and exercise equipment and technology leadership. And I think he could have done better than the earbuds that he's using to talk to Bloomberg, he could have had a more professional setup. But overall, how does Foley look? Better than not on the balance of it all. The financials of a business are obviously the lifeblood of any listed company. And of course, now we go to the Peloton Investor Relations page where we see in the 3 months ended March, the latest numbers available. You can see that Peloton has got two revenue streams. One is the connected fitness products, which are the treadmills, the bicycles, the accessories and what have you. And then you've also got the subscription where you have to sign up on a monthly fee to get access to the instructors like Beck Gentry. So they make about $1.3 billion in the third quarter ended March, of which around about a fifth comes from subscriptions, but the main bulk of it comes from equipment. Now, of course, 9 months as well, you can see that at that point in time, they have more than doubled 9 month revenue from a year ago from fitness products, as well as doubling what they make from subscriptions. So obviously, overall, on a 9 month basis from a year earlier, they have nearly tripled what they made in terms of revenue from a year earlier. So in terms of trajectory, that is good. To answer the question of who owns Peloton, one turns now to CNN Business and you click through to the shareholder section. You can see that by clicking on institutional ownership, you find that individuals only own less than 8% of Peloton. Institutionals own nearly 40%, and mutual fund holders own about 37%. One thing to note is that the more institutionalized a company, the better, because obviously they do adhere to rules of corporate governance and minority shareholder protection, which is good for people like you and me. Now, in terms of institutional ownership, you can see that Vanguard is at nearly 8%. The biggest owner of Peloton, they have been buying shares over the course of the last few weeks. Other companies like Baillie Gifford, Jennison Associates, Capital, BlackRock. BlackRock's a big one. Capital is in there as well. They're another big one. Tiger Global, Fidelity, Gilda, Ganyan and Ho. So some of the biggest institutions in the world are owners of Peloton, which is a good sign. Now, mutual funds like the following that belong to American Funds and Vanguard and Invest, these are typically long-only funds, which means that they hold stock in companies like Peloton for the long term, and that can only be a good sign because they see the long-term potential of this business. So overall, quite a good sign. Individuals are small participants in the business, and institutionals are nearly 80%, which is, again, good. To answer the question of what the future holds for Peloton, one can have a bit of a cheat sheet and again go to CNN Business, where you can tell that there's 29 analysts that cover the stock, well, 29 polled by CNN that cover the stock, and the consensus, which is basically the groupthink where it comes to Peloton, is to buy the stock. 21 say buy, 2 are an outperform, 4 are a hold, no underperforms, and 2 are a sell. So generally speaking, the analysts are quite bullish on Peloton. And basically, on a share price target basis, there's a median target of $135 on Peloton. Today, they're trading at about $110. High, the highest estimate, the most optimistic guy is $185 on Peloton. The most pessimistic on Peloton is $45. So basically, they take the median target of $135, which means at that point, there could be a 23% upside from the last price over $109, or rather $110 at this point in time. So whether or not one should buy any stock, it's a very subjective question that you must answer. You must ask yourself, do you have the liquid funds? Do you have the risk profile? Do you have the ability to buy stocks? And if you have stocks, do you want to buy a local stock, American stock? Do you want to buy technology? So again, everybody is different. Everybody has a very specific set of circumstances. So it's a very personal decision. On a general level, though, you know that work from home is kind of like a normalcy from here on in. You know that exercise is increasingly important because the more healthy one is, the more able one's immunity system has in terms of being able to ward off the virus. So generally speaking, a company which offers high-tech, cool exercise equipment with a very compelling content proposition at attractive prices that can be paid for over the course of a few months is always going to have a future, at least for the medium term. Now, let's see what the experts say. And I came across this company called Orchid Global Markets. And this is what they've talked about. They've said that overall, the streaming workout industry is fairly new. There's more than enough room for the competition to grow. Peloton has already made a name for itself, and it's been able to gain a cult following, which is, I guess, true in some degree. It's got a solid foundation, which it has, right? Obviously, you can see the numbers. It can build itself upon. It can be at the forefront and can lead the industry. It's been growing consistently year after year. And of course, it's had recent troubles with the supply, not being able to meet the demand, and some injuries, and even I think in a case of a couple of instances, a death or two. But it's again, more likely than not, Peloton will become profitable within the next few years. So again, on the balance of it all, it's a very specific question that you must ask yourself on a very specific level. But generally speaking, Peloton seems to be something to be considered over the medium term, at least.